but I got another favourite. Sorry, a bit louder. 3-3-3. 3-2-3. 3-2-3. We'll sing the first two verses and the last verse, verse 7. 323, first two verses and verse 7, please. Page previous, far away the noise of strife upon my ear is falling. We'll sing the first verse anyway and the chorus. Singing your very best, you're singing really well, so keep it up. Verse 1 of 319 and the chorus to begin with.
Hymn number 203, as you're finding your place, let me thank our brother Mr. Bell for leading the singing. Hymn number 203, I was sinking deep in sin, sinking to rise no more, overwhelmed by guilt within, mercy I did implore. And we have a hallelujah in this chorus, so we'll try and sing it out to the best of our ability. 203, standing after the introduction. Let's stand together.
I was sinking deep in sin, sinking to rise no more. Overwhelmed by guilt within, mercy I did implore. In the luster of the sea, heard my despairing cry. Christ my Savior,
verse. We're singing well, but I think we could sing better. And when we come to that hallelujah, really try and lift the roof. It's a tremendous thing to sing hallelujah. That's the Hebrew word, praise the Lord. We've got so much to praise the Lord for. So 203, verse 2, and let's really step up that singing.
Souls in danger look above, Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea, it was his will obey. He your Savior wants to be saved.
That's good singing. And what a tremendous truth. Love lifted me when no one but Christ could help. Love lifted me. Now let's bow in a word of prayer together, please. Let's have every head bowed, every eye closed as we approach God the Father in prayer. And let us all pray. Eternal God and loving Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for Thy wonderful love toward us. We realize that we are so undeserving of it. In our sin, we deserve hell. We deserve wrath. We deserve death. We deserve judgment. We deserve everything which Thou hast not yet given us. And we thank Thee that in its place, in Christ, You have given us love and mercy and grace. We thank Thee for the shedding of precious blood, not just any blood, but divine blood, the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, incorruptible blood. We thank Thee that that blood washes sins away and makes souls as white as snow. We thank Thee for the promise that in Christ, when the blood that was shed has washed away our sin, there is then the promise of heaven and home. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And we thank Thee for the promises of Thy holy word. What tremendous hope lies before the Christian. We thank Thee that this old world, with all of its sin and darkness and wickedness, is not our home. We thank Thee that the trinkets of this life are not what we are living for, but we rejoice that heaven is ours, mansions, streets paved with gold, the angelic choir singing the praises of the Lord Jesus Christ, the tremendous privilege of being forever with the Lord. Oh God, we come before Thee and we rejoice with thankful hearts, and we do shout out, hallelujah, praise the Lord for all that Christ has done. Accomplished for us in His life, in His death, in His resurrection, and His ascension. And we thank Thee that one day He's coming back for us too. How we rejoice that one day Christ with the heavenly host is going to break through the clouds, and one day we will be caught up together to meet him in the air. Oh, what a day, glorious day that will be. And oh God, we pray tonight, if there's one in our meeting, whether they be the oldest in the meeting or the youngest in the meeting, whoever it is, some soul yet in their sin, oh God, how we pray that thou would show them that their sin will only bring death, and death will bring hell, and hell will then consummate in the lake of fire for all eternity. And oh God, we pray that while they're in this gospel service and gospel opportunity after gospel opportunity is brought to the soul, how we pray that they would seek the Lord while he may be found, call upon him while he is near. How we pray that souls are prepared to meet their God tonight. We ask that this church in Monish Lane would know what it is to enjoy that great rejoicing with the whole of heaven over one sinner that repenteth. And oh God, we pray, give us faith. Give us faith to believe that thou can save not just one soul tonight, but you can save a whole host of souls. Lord, we have prayed in the prayer meeting for revival to come. Oh God, we pray, give us expectant faith to believe that thou canst send that revival, that you can revive thy people, that you can set us on fire for thee, that you can draw the backslider back unto thyself, that you can save every single unconverted soul in this meeting. Oh God, move amongst us tonight. Send thy Holy Spirit to be one of our number. And we pray, Holy Spirit of God, move from pew to pew and from heart to heart and move upon the need of every single soul tonight. Lord, thou knowest those that need to be revived. Thou knowest those that need to come back into the fold after being in Bypath Meadow. Lord, thou knowest those who need to be saved. Holy Spirit of God, we pray, perform an eternal work in Monish Lane tonight. And we ask that we would have the joy and real joy and lasting joy of knowing this gospel service has been crowned with redemption and thy seal has been placed and put upon the truth that was preached and declared. So, oh God, answer our cry, we plead. Lord, remember those who can't be with us. Thou knowest there are those that for decades were so faithful to this place, and we thank thee for their love and their support for this work, and now they just can't be out. Age and infirmity and sickness just doesn't allow. Lord, we pray, comfort those hearts tonight. Bless those hearts. We know that many of them set aside the time, even now as the hour has struck seven, they set this hour aside for prayer. Lord, bless them. Help them, encourage them. Remember those that aren't out, and they should be out, and they could be out, Lord. Warm their hearts, we pray. And Lord, how we pray for those that are sorrowing tonight. Oh, Lord, thou knowest there are many hearts that are maybe feeling overwhelmed with grief. Lord, we pray for the Morrow family. We pray for the family of that young boy. And Lord, it breaks our hearts to think of that tragic accident with that 17-year-old, and we just pray that thou bless and help that family circle. Lord, thou art the God of all comfort, and we pray that saving comfort would come to that family circle for those that don't yet know and love thee. And we pray that thou bless those that already are thy children, that they would be those that know great help and great wisdom, even in these very, very difficult of circumstances. But Lord, we pray that thou glorify thy name tonight. Give us help tonight. We ask that everything from the very first word to the very last, amen, will be said and done to thine honor and to thy glory alone. Bless us, we pray, for we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Hymn number 211. 211. There is a story sweet to hear. I love to tell it too. It fills my heart with hope and cheer. 'Tis old, yet ever new. Let's stand together after the introduction, hymn number 211. Let's stand together. Amen. Now, turning in the Word of God together, please, to Psalm 77. Psalm 77. And if you're using a church Bible in the pew in front of you, you'll find the reading on page 629. Page 629, but Psalm 77. And in a moment, God willing, we're going to be taking the verse 1 as our text. We're going to be looking at the title, The Sinner's Cry. The Sinner's Cry. And I trust tonight, if there's one yet unsaved and still in their sin, that you'll cry unto God as the psalmist does here. And there's those tremendous words of promise. He gave ear unto me. The Lord hears the sinner's cry. But Psalm 77, we'll read the entirety of the psalm together. We'll read the title. The title of the psalm is part of the psalm in the original. To the chief musician, to Jeduthun, a psalm of Asaph. Verse 1. I cried unto God with my voice, even unto God with my voice, and he gave ear unto me. In the day of my trouble I sought the Lord. My sore ran in the night and ceased not. My soul refused to be comforted. I remembered God and was troubled. I complained and my spirit was overwhelmed. Selah. Thou holdest mine eyes waking. I am so troubled that I cannot speak. I have considered the days of old, the years of ancient times. I call to remembrance my song in the night. I commune with mine own heart, and my spirit made diligent search. Will the Lord cast off forever, and will he be favorable no more? Is his mercy clean gone forever? Doth his promise fail forevermore? Hath God forgotten to be gracious? Hath he in anger shut up his tender mercies? Selah. And I said, this is my infirmity, but I will remember the years of the right hand of the Most High. I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I will remember thy wonders of old. I will meditate also of all thy work and talk of thy doings. Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great a God as our God? Thou art the God that doest wonders. Thou hast declared thy strength among the people. Thou hast with thine arm redeemed thy people, the sons of Jacob and Joseph. Selah. The waters saw thee, O God, the waters saw thee. They were afraid. The depths also were troubled. The clouds poured out water, the skies sent out a sound, thine arrows also went abroad. The voice of thy thunder was in the heaven, the lightnings lightened the world, the earth trembled and shook. Thy way is in the sea, and thy path in the great waters, and thy footsteps are not known. Thou ledest thy people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron. We trust the Lord to bless the public reading of his holy and precious word to each of our hearts for his own name's sake. At this point in the meeting, let me welcome each one to the house of God tonight. It's good to see you, and we trust the Lord will bless us as we gather around the scriptures of truth even this evening. For the week ahead of us, for the committee, please remember, brethren, Monday, the committee are meeting at 8 p.m. in the session room of the church. Then on Tuesday, the gospel bus meeting at 7 p.m. for all the boys and girls. And if you know of any that don't yet attend, we've been greatly encouraged in recent weeks. Every single week thus far, the numbers have increased, and we're very thankful for that. But if you know if there's any other boys and girls in this locality, or children, grandchildren and the like, and they're not yet coming, you bring them or invite them or tell them about the meetings Tuesday at 7 p.m., Then on Wednesday, the Bible study and prayer meeting at 8 p.m., continuing on with our series in the book of James. Then on Friday, the youth fellowship. It's our end of year trip this coming Friday. And we're going to Laser Quest and bowling as well. We're going to be leaving the church here at 7:15 sharp. 7:15 sharp. So if there's any parents that haven't yet confirmed that their children are going, please speak to our brother, Mr. Peter Bowles, today. And today is your last opportunity, so we can get that all booked up for Friday. But please remember that confirmed numbers with our brother Peter, and we're leaving on Friday, 7:15 sharp. That means if you're not on the bus at 7:15, we're driving away, whether you've confirmed it or not. We've got to be there in good time. So then the service is next Lord's Day, Sabbath school and Bible class at 10:45, morning worship at 12 noon, preceded by a half hour prayer. After our morning worship service, we're coming around the Lord's table and remembering the Lord's death in his own appointed manner. So please remember that communion after the morning service. We have the joy of welcoming two new members at that. And then the evening gospel service at 7 p.m., preceded by a half-hour prayer beginning at 6:30. Now today is our maintenance fund offering. Please do remember that. Then next Lord's Day, our retiring missionary offering. Some dates for the diary. Please remember the special meetings that we plan to hold in June. That's nearly upon us. Hard to believe we're halfway through the year. But Friday the 14th of June at 8 p.m., our baptismal service in our Banbridge Church. And then our week of meetings on the end times with the Reverend David McMillan, the 23rd through to the 28th of June. The Trinitarian Bible Society quarterly record is at the door. Please take those with you. And if you know if there's any shut in, maybe in your locality, and you know they would appreciate that literature, please take it for them as well. We want that to get into the hands of God's people. But please do continue to pray for those that are sick at this time. There seems to be a number that are sick in our church family. Please remember them, those that are shut in and those that have been bereaved of late and feeling very keenly the loss of loved ones, even in recent days. Please remember them all. But all these announcements are subject to the will and mind of the Lord. But we'll have our offering hymn now, hymn number 213. Hymn number 213, keeping our seats for the first part of this hymn, while our tithes and offerings are collected for the work of God in this place. Was it for me alone, the Saviour left his glorious throne, the dazzling splendours of the sky? Was it for me he came to die? 213, keeping our seats.
Thank you.
Now, we're turning in the Word of God back to that portion we read earlier, please. Psalm 77. Psalm 77 in the verse 1 is our text, looking at the title, The Sinner's Cry. The Sinner's Cry. And Psalm 77, verse 1 states, I cried unto God with my voice, even unto God with my voice, and he gave ear unto me. I cried unto God with my voice, even unto God with my voice, and he gave ear unto me. With our Bibles open before God, let's bow in a word of prayer. Let's ask for the Lord's help. Let's ask for the Lord's blessing upon the preaching of his truth tonight. Eternal God and loving Heavenly Father, we thank thee and we praise thee for the gospel. We thank thee that tonight we have a gospel to preach. We have good news to declare. We realize in our sin we don't deserve a gospel. We don't deserve good news. In our sin we deserve only the bad news of hell, wrath, and destruction. Yet we rejoice there is good news to tell. My Jesus hath done all things well. And we do pray that there would be some soul in this meeting that cries unto thee, that cries unto God. And we thank thee for those tremendous words. He gave ear unto me. O God, answer our cries. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Psalm 77 was written with some calamity in view. I don't know what that calamity or that disaster was, but I know that some terrible incident had happened, because look at verses 1 through to 3. It says, I cried unto God with my voice, even unto God with my voice, and he gave ear unto me. Look at the verse 2. In the day of my trouble, I sought the Lord. My soul ran in the night and ceased not. My soul refused to be comforted. I remembered God and was troubled. I complained, and my spirit was overwhelmed. You don't talk like that if that's not a day of calamity. We read of a day of trouble. We read of crying. We read of overwhelming. We read of complaining. We read of being refused to be comforted. This was a terrible thing that had happened. Some calamity has taken place. In fact, this calamity that has taken place, it's so bad that the psalmist feels as though he just can't see God in all that has taken place. At times we feel like that. Now let me underline something here. At no stage is God not there. At no stage is God not in control. But the psalmist feels, and at times, if we're honest, we feel the same way, where we say, where is God in this situation? This is so terrible, this calamity. Where is the Lord? We read that in the verse 7 and following. Look what it says. Will the Lord cast off forever? Will he be favorable no more? Verse 8. Is his mercy clean gone forever? Doth his promise fail forevermore? Verse 9. Hath God forgotten to be gracious? Hath he in anger shut up his tender mercies? At times we feel like that. But you know, in verses 10 and following, we then find that the psalmist seems to change his tune, seems to remember something, seems to remember that this calamity isn't God's fault at all. In fact, he owns up to it and he says, this calamity, it's my own fault. It's my infirmity. Look what it says in the verse 10. It says, and I said, this is my infirmity, but I will remember the years of the right hand of the Most High. I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I will remember thy wonders of old. I will meditate also of all thy work and talk of thy doings. You see, verse 10 is very telling. He says, this is my infirmity. How often we see that, and we've noted that in our studies in the book of James, if you want to turn to James chapter 1. How often we live in a world that when something goes wrong, when disaster strikes, when calamity befalls us, people are very quick to blame God, aren't they? They're very quick to say it's God's fault here. And yet the psalmist remembers, it's my infirmity, it's my day of trouble. And James 1 and the verse 13 and 14 teaches the exact same thing, that anything sinful that takes place, it's not God's fault, it's our fault. You say, really? Is it always our fault? Well, let me put it this way. The only reason why bad things happen is because sin is in the world. And sin is a consequence of Adam and our actions in Adam. Therefore, sin and anything calamitous that ever takes place, you can always pin the blame back to my infirmity, my calamity. And it says in James 1 verse 13, let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust, and enticed. The psalmist learns that halfway down this psalm. He realizes that the problem is me, my, I. And then toward the end of the psalm, he goes from lamenting this calamity, not seeing God in all that's taken place, realizing actually it's his own fault, to then turning in verses 13 through to 15 and realizing toward the end of the psalm that actually God is his only hope in a time of calamity. Look what it says, verse 13. Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great a God as our God? Thou art the God that doest wonders. Thou hast declared thy strength among the people. Thou hast with thine arm redeemed thy people, the sons of Jacob and Joseph. You know, it'd be very easy to blame and point a finger at the psalmist and say, how dare you? But how often we are the same. How often we possess the exact same attitude where at times something goes wrong, we blame God, we then after a bit of thought realize it's our own fault, and then eventually we come round to the position we should have had in the very first place, and that is that God is my only hope. He is my only trust. And he's the only one that can actually rescue me from this calamity. Now, we don't know what this calamity is in Psalm 77. Some commentators like to guess. They like to surmise. Some think maybe it was to do with the Babylonian captivity. That was a calamity for Israel and Judah, wasn't it? That was a calamity where because of their own sin, God had allowed the Babylonians to come in to destroy Jerusalem, the temple burned with fire, the walls knocked down, and they'd taken away as slaves into a foreign land. 70 years of bondage. Calamity. Maybe that's what the psalmist is talking about. In fact, some commentators actually say, maybe this is a prophecy. Maybe it's talking of future events. Maybe it's speaking of the future day when the church will feel as though it's in a time of calamity at the time of Antichrist in those years before the Lord's return. Now, we can only surmise, but I would submit that it's far more likely that this was something personal to the psalmist. Something personal to the psalmist. And we find a tremendous verse at the start of our psalm, the verse 1. I cried unto God with my voice. Even unto God with my voice, and he gave ear unto me. And we find he starts in the same vein that he ends, realizing that God is his only hope. God is his only trust. God is the only one that can bring deliverance in his calamity. Therefore, we're looking at the verse 1 and considering the verse 1 under the title, The Sinner's Cry. The Sinner's Cry. I want you to note three things, the first of which is this. The reason for crying. The reason for crying. Look what it says, verse 1, first two words. I cried. I cried. Well, naturally, you say, why? Why? Well, we don't know the specifics of this psalm, as I've already said. But some calamity is there, some problem is there that the psalmist is lamenting. I don't know what it is. But something I can apply to each one that is gathered in the meeting tonight, it's this, that every single one of us have a calamity. What is that calamity? It's a sin problem. S-I-N, sin. It's only a small word, and yet it's a calamity. It's disastrous. It's tragic, with tragic results if you remain in your sin. Come with me to Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2, you want to ask maybe, where did it all begin? Where did this calamity first start? Well, it started when mankind chose to disobey God's law. That's where our calamity and sin began. And that's something worth crying over. When we read the psalmist say, I cried unto God. Well, that's something worth crying over, your sin. And we read in Genesis 2 and the verse 17, the Lord gave a clear command, only one commandment in the law of God at this stage before the fall in creation week. It says in Genesis 2 verse 17, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. I don't know about you, but I think that's perfectly plain. There's no other language that could have made it any simpler, any easier to understand. The Lord didn't use flowery language. He didn't beat about the bush. It's very black and white, plain. In the day thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. What do we find? Genesis 3 verse 6. At the end of it, it said that Eve did eat and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. You say that sounds like a very small, a minor misdemeanor. Well, I want to tell you, that was the very first sin, and sin entered the world. In fact, Romans chapter 5 tells us something of that. Romans 5 verse 12 tells us just how serious it is. Tells us that that sin, that calamity, that disaster, well, it transformed the entirety of world history. And we find that it affects you and I tonight. For it says in Romans 5 verse 12, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. You see, where did our calamity begin? When we're reading in Psalm 77 and the psalmist is saying, I cried. There's some calamity befallen me. There's some problem. There's some issue. There's some disaster. There's something happened. Well, where did our calamity begin? It began all the way back in Genesis chapter 3 when sin entered the world, when the fall came in, when we chose disobedience against God's law. And then, well, is that it? No. Because of the fall, because of all that took place in the Garden of Eden, well, you and I were born with a sin nature. A sin nature. Come with me to Jeremiah 17. Jeremiah 17 and the verse 9. And, you know, I'll be honest with you, there's a whole lot of hogwash that's preached from pulpits nowadays, and you hear a lot of it on the news and all the rest of it, where maybe something happens and people maybe come in afterwards with charity and all the rest of it, and you'll hear phrases like, well, I believe in the goodness of humanity. Well, I believe and that there's some inherent goodness in everybody. Well, friend, I want to tell you, that's a lie of the devil. There's no inherent goodness in us. Our sin is serious. We are born with a sin nature. And it says in Jeremiah 17 verse 9, concerning your heart and mine, when we're born in our sin, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? You see, people have that theory, that notion, they talk about it. Just follow your heart. Whatever you're going to do in life, just follow your heart. Friend, my advice as a preacher of the word is do anything but follow your heart. Your heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. You follow your heart, you'll just delve into deeper and further sin. You see, that's the issue. They're born with a sin nature. But then come with me to Exodus 20. We find where it all started, our calamity started. We find that we're born with a sin nature, and ever since, we have been actively breaking God's law. Actively breaking God's law. That's been our issue. Actively breaking God's law. Exodus 20 verse 3. You know, people will say, well, why do you keep preaching on sin at a gospel service? Why do you keep preaching the law of God at a gospel service? I believe you can't tell the good news without first telling the bad news. You can't tell people to believe if they don't realize why they're believing. Friend, you've got to deal with the law. The law is the schoolmaster that brings us to Christ. In Exodus 20 gives us that law. Look at the verse 3. It says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Maybe you say, well, I don't bow down to other gods. I don't have another wee god on my mantelpiece at home. I don't have any other gods. But do you? Do you not? Has there ever been anything in your life that has come ahead of Almighty God? Well, then that's idolatry. That's a graven image in your life. Look what it says in the verse 4. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them nor serve them. You say, but I don't do that. I don't have a god made of wood or of silver or gold, or I don't have a concrete pillar or anything like that, or a totem pole or anything I bow down to, but is there anything in your life that comes ahead of God? Any material thing maybe that comes ahead of God in your life? Maybe it's your bank account. Maybe it's your car. Maybe it's your home. Maybe it's the farm. Maybe it's business. Maybe it's even your family. Well, what is that? It's essentially a graven image. It's a breaking of this commandment. Let's keep reading the Ten Commandments. It makes for terrifying reading when we realize and we're honest with ourselves that we are lawbreakers. It says in the verse 7, the third commandment, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. You know, I find it interesting that if you ever hear someone invoking a name of a deity, they always refer to God, Jesus Christ, or the Lord, don't they? Isn't it interesting that no one ever invokes the name of Allah, Muhammad, Buddha, Krishna? they don't ever invoke anybody else's name. You want to know why? Because naturally within the sinful heart, man actually knows who God is, and man longs to break his law in his natural sin, and he wants to take in vain the name of Almighty God and his name alone. You say, but I don't do that. But do you watch the television and that does it and you don't turn it off? Do you listen to friends and they tell those sort of jokes and you smile at them and encourage them and say nothing? Friend, we're lawless. It says in the verse 8, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Now, you say, well, is that broken? I'm at church tonight, but if you look around, there's many that aren't, isn't there? I find that sad, I'll be honest with you. If the whole day is holy unto the Lord, then I see no reason why someone shouldn't be in the house of God. It doesn't say, remember the Sabbath hour to keep it holy. It says, remember the Sabbath day. That's a 24-hour day, friend. That's the Sabbath. Look at the verse 12. Honor thy father and thy mother. We're all guilty. Every single one of our parents could testify to that fact. At one stage or another, we dishonored them. Look what it says, verse 13, verse 14, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery. You say, but I'm not that bad, preacher. I try and live a clean life, a moral life, a tidy life. Never killed anyone, never committed adultery. But the Lord in the New Testament compares hatred to murder. He compares lustful looking to the physical act of adultery. We find that if we're honest, we're lawless. We're lawless. It says in verse 15, thou shalt not steal. Doesn't matter whether you're robbing a bank or stealing a pencil. If you've ever stolen, you've stolen maybe something you don't consider. Ever stolen time from an employer? You're given so much time for a break and you took more and you stole even time. Stealing money from them, that's what it is. Verse 16, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor lies. Doesn't matter what shade you want to call it. Doesn't matter if you say it's a white lie, a pink lie, a blue lie, a green lie. All liars have their part in the lake of fire. Lie is a lie, and that's it. Sinful. It's breaking God's law. Thou shalt not covet. Thou shalt not covet. How often have we coveted something that somebody else has? It wasn't ours. We know it never will be ours. Yet we desired it, didn't we? You know, if we're honest, and we look at God's law, we find that, yes, our calamity of sin, it began with the fall in the Garden of Eden. We were born in sin, shapen in iniquity, but continually we have been active in our breaking of God's law in our sin. Why do you think Romans 3, verse 23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God? All of us have fallen short of God's standard. Every single one of us is guilty. Come with me to Luke 16. Luke 16. I want you to note, we have a reason for crying. When the psalmist says, I cried, I want you to catch a glimpse of how serious lawlessness is in the sight of God. I want you to catch a glimpse of how serious your commandment breaking really is. I want you to catch a glimpse of how serious it is to disobey against a holy and righteous God after he has clearly set out his law. And the reality is, sin deserves hell. Sin deserves hell. And it says in Luke 16, look at the verse 23. It says, concerning a rich man, that had everything this world could ever buy. He had everything by way of comforts in this life. But look what it says. Look where his sin brings him, friend. Verse 23. And in hell, he lift up his eyes, being in torments. And then it goes on, verse 24. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. For I am tormented in this flame. And we find there at the end of the verse 25 and the start of the verse 26 that there is no escape from hell. There is no fire escape. There is no reprieve. It says, but now he is comforted and now are tormented. And beside all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed. Now, maybe you're in this meeting and you say, well, preacher, I don't believe you that sin is that serious. Maybe you say, like Hebrews, I'm going to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. I tell you, you can try and enjoy your sin in this life all you want, but that season will run out one day, and it will run out quicker than you think. And hell is forever. Hell is eternal. And still, over 2,000 years on from when the Lord told of that rich man in Luke 16, that man is still in hell tonight, and he's still crying in torment, and he's still crying out for a drop of water to cool his tongue. He's still crying out in the tortures of the fire. I want to tell you this. When the psalmist says in Psalm 77 and the verse 1, I cried, your sin is a calamity that you need to cry for help from. That's what that word cried means in Psalm 77. I cried, literally a cry for help. There is danger here. There is trouble here. There is a calamity here. And I need help. Will you acknowledge that tonight? Will you acknowledge that? Or will you laugh in your sin? Will you take pleasure in your sin? Or tonight, for the first time, will you do the wisest thing you've ever done in your life? And will you cry unto God? Will you cry unto God for help? Because your sin is serious. Your sin deserves hell. And in your sin, that is where you will go. Unless you cry and cry unto the Lord. We have a reason for crying. But then secondly, I want you to note not only the reason for crying, but number two, the recipient of the crying. The recipient of the crying. Psalm 77 verse 1 tells you who you are to cry to. Now there's many people in our world that are freely acknowledging that they're sinners. They're happy to acknowledge they're not good enough. They're happy to acknowledge that they're sinners. Happy to acknowledge they need help. They're crying out to help. But do you know what I find sad? So many are crying out to the wrong person and going to the wrong place. So many. You think even in our own province tonight, you think half of our population in Northern Ireland, approximately half anyway, they're Roman Catholic. And yes, many a Roman Catholic will acknowledge, I'm a sinner. If I stay in my sin, I'm going to hell. They want salvation. They desire salvation. Friend, I hate no one. I have a love and a sympathy for the Roman Catholic. My mother, my grandmother were Roman Catholics before the Lord saved them by his grace. The Lord can save Roman Catholics, by the way. I want you to pray to that end. The Lord can save those in our community that don't have any of the gospel influences that Protestant loyalism has ever enjoyed. Protestantism has seemingly turned its back on the gospel long ago. Well, listen, pray for the Roman Catholic. Pray, because they acknowledge they're sinners. They acknowledge in their sin they will go to hell. But do you know where they go instead? They go to the confessional. And they recite all of their sins to the priest. And then that priest has the audacity, and I mean that, the audacity, as a sinner himself, to say, I absolve you. He has no power to forgive sin. What's the Roman Catholic doing? They're acknowledging their sin. They want rid of their sin, but they're going to the wrong place to get rid of their sin. They go to Mass, a blasphemy, where Rome will teach that the bread and the wine becomes the body and blood of Christ. It is a blasphemy against the finished work of the cross. Where else does the Roman Catholic go? They'll go and pray to the saints and say Hail Marys and all of those things. They'll give money to the Church of Rome, all the rest of it. You think of others, you think of the Muslim. The Muslim, same idea, acknowledging they're a sinner, acknowledging they need help. Acknowledging in their sin they will end up in a lost eternity. And yet where do they go? They go to the Quran. They go to the mosque. They travel thousands of miles to Mecca. At times you find in some countries this extremism of jihad, so-called holy war, when if you kill the infidels, then hopefully, possibly, you'll get into heaven. Listen, what is it? That is sinners acknowledging they need to be saved, but going to the wrong place. Psalm 77 in the verse 1 tells us where you need to go. Psalm 77 in the verse 1 tells you the recipient of the crying. It says, look at it, I cried, look at it now, unto God. I cried unto God. And isn't it interesting how the psalmist repeats that truth? It says in the verse 1, I cried unto God with my voice, even unto God with my voice. The sinner friend, if you're coming to Monash Lane Free Presbyterian Church for the Free Presbyterian Church to save you, you'll be disappointed. I wouldn't cross the road to make you a Free Presbyterian member, but if I felt, friend, I could see you one to Christ, I would go to the lengths of the earth. It's Christ that you need, not a church, not a denomination, not a preacher, not a pope, not a priest, not any man. You need Christ. That's who you need. You need the God-man. You need Christ. And if you want to be saved, you say, where do I go? Where are you going to point me, preacher? If I stay behind and I want to get saved, where are you going to point me? I'm going to point you to the same place as the psalmist points you. I cried unto God, unto God. That's the way. That's the way of salvation. And why unto God? Well, think of those tremendous gospel verses. Think of John 3, verse 16. For who? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You think of Romans 5 and the verse 8. What does it say? But, and who's the next? Who's the name? But God commendeth his love toward us. And that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Why is it that you come to God? Well, I tell you, you come to God because you cannot save yourself. It's not possible to save yourself. Yes, you could go to church, you could do good works, you could give to charity, you could do all those things. But friend, Ephesians 2 verses 8 and 9 says, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. Where does it come from? It says, it is the gift of God. The gift of God. That's why you're crying unto God. And the verse 9 says, not of works, lest any man should boast. So when the psalmist says, I cried unto God with my voice, even unto God with my voice, he makes it plain. You want salvation? You pray the sinner's prayer unto God, because it is God that has made a way of salvation. Oh, it is God the Father that sent God the Son to this wicked world of ours. It is God the Son, Jesus Christ, that became God manifest in the flesh. And as the God-man, he lived a perfectly righteous life. And he died. Christ died for the ungodly. He died for sinners. He died for us in the calamity of our sin. He died so that we could be redeemed. He shed his blood. And 1 John 1 verse 7 says, the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, God's Son, cleanseth us from all sin. Why do I cry unto God? Because God made a way. God provides salvation. God is the author and finisher of redemption. Calvary is real. It is Calvary that is God's appointed way. And if you want to be saved tonight, you must come to God, God's way. And that's through the precious blood of Jesus Christ. You say, what do I have to do? What does it really look like? Crying unto God. It's repenting and believing the gospel. Turning from your sin. Asking God to forgive you of your sin. And believing that when Jesus Christ died, when Jesus Christ made a way for sinners, he did it for you. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. I cried unto God with my voice, even unto God with my voice. But then we find not only the reason for crying, because of the calamity of our sin, the recipient of the crying unto God, God alone, God alone. Thirdly, the response to the crying. The response to the crying. There's a lovely line at the end of the verse 1. I want you to look at it with me. It says, I cried unto God with my voice, even unto God with my voice. Look at it now. Isn't this lovely? And he gave ear unto me. And he gave ear unto me. What's the response to our crying? Let me say this. God had every right. When he hears your cry, God had every right to say, you deserve everything that's coming to you. He had every right as the holy, just, and righteous God to say you will end up in a lost eternity, and that's what you deserve. He had every right to do that. But instead, we read in our Bibles that God is gracious. God is loving. God is merciful. You know, I think sometimes people misunderstand the different definitions between grace and mercy. Grace means unmerited favor. God gives us something we don't deserve. Mercy's different. Mercy is God giving us not only his grace, something we don't deserve, but God giving us something we don't deserve when we do deserve to be punished. When we do deserve wrath and judgment and hell, mercy is God withholding that punishment and also giving us his grace. It really is a tremendous word, mercy. But isn't it wonderful to know that in our calamity, crying over our sin, crying for help, crying unto God, the author of salvation, he does really hear us. He does hear us. It says in the verse 1, he gave ear unto me. He gave ear unto me. You know, friend, I want to be perfectly clear tonight, because maybe this will be your last gospel opportunity, but the reality of the situation is, this is just straight up black and white reality. I deserve hell. You deserve hell. We deserve nothing from God. That is the reality. And yet grace is offered. Redemption is offered. God promises to hear the sinner's cry. He doesn't ignore us if we cry out in repentance and faith. Come with me to 1 John chapter 1 and the verse 9. 1 John chapter 1 and the verse 9. We find a tremendous promise. Maybe there's someone here and you say, but preacher, you don't know my sin. You don't know what I've done. Maybe even though I've said about the person trying to earn their way to heaven and good works to heaven and all the rest of it, maybe you'll want to say, you don't know what I'm like. I've spoken to people like this, doing personal one-on-one evangelism, and people have said to me, you don't know what I'm like. I deserve hell. They say, I'm so much a sinner that God could never save me. I've heard people say that. 1 John 1 and the verse 9 says the exact opposite, friend. What does it say? It says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from unrighteousness. No, it doesn't just say that. From all unrighteousness. Isn't that little word all wonderful? that every single sin, every single stain, every single iniquity, every single transgression, every single sin, every single unrighteousness cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Cleanses us from all of it. All of it. Isn't it wonderful? Come with me to Luke 18. You say, but preach still. I hear what you're saying, but you don't know what I'm like. Well, I want you to see in Luke 18, there's a man that at the same vein may have for years said, you don't know what I'm like. We read of his profession. We don't read his name. We read he was a publican. And in the eyes of many, in the eyes of most, certainly in the eyes of the Pharisee that was stood on that same street corner, here's a man that was so wicked he couldn't be saved. Here's a man that couldn't receive redemption, according to the Pharisee, that is. Isn't it amazing that no heart is too hard for the Lord? No sin is too deep for the Lord not being able to cleanse it? And we read in Luke 18, look at it, verse 13. It says, and the publican standing afar off would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, isn't it interesting? Who's the name he invokes? Who does he cry unto? Same as the psalmist tells us, he cries unto God, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Look at the verse 14. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified. You know what I find tremendous? Come with me to John chapter 6. John chapter 6. When we read in our psalm that the psalmist cried unto the Lord, and the psalmist cried unto God, and God heard him. I want you to note this, that God always answers in a merciful way. That God is yet to and will never refuse the sinner that comes in genuine repentance and faith. God will always accept the sinner's cry, those that genuinely desire to be redeemed. And it says in John 6, verse 37, all that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me, look at it, I will in no wise cast out. I will in no wise cast out. There has never been a moment that a sinner has prayed, asking for salvation, repenting and believing, and God has said, no, not today. It's never happened. It never will happen. The Word of God says, I will in no wise cast out. Everybody that calls coming to God, God's way, will be accepted, will be saved, will become a Christian, will become a new creature in Christ. So, friend, I tell you, as we look at Psalm 77 and the verse 1, I cried, well, there's a calamity. We don't know what the psalmist's calamity is, but we know what our own is. It's sin. I cried unto God. That's where our hope lies. I cried unto God with my voice, even unto God with my voice. And he gave ear unto me. God answers in mercy, in love, and in grace. And I ask, if you stand in need of Christ tonight, will you not be saved? Will you not come to God? Will you not repent and believe the gospel? You know, the scriptures say, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. I'm just being straight with you. What are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? Even in the past week, we've heard of a tragic, tragic, tragic death. Listen to me. The old must die, but the young may die. And we are told in Proverbs 27, boast not thyself of tomorrow, for no man knows what a day may bring forth. I don't know whether I will see the morning. I don't know whether tomorrow will ever come for my soul. But if it doesn't come, it doesn't matter, for I'll be forever with the Lord. But friend, if you die in your sin and you don't see the morning, friend, you will never see anything beautiful again. You will wake up in hell and you'll be in those torments with no reprieve, no easement. And forever in torment. Oh, friend, turn to Christ. Be in time, the scriptures say, it is time to seek the Lord. The scriptures say, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I trust that each one will do that tonight. That you come to Christ, that you be saved. that you'll be in time. You may have come into this meeting in a calamity, but you can leave this meeting converted. You can know that you're saved. You can know that you're heaven bound if you do what the psalmist did in Psalm 77, verse 1. I cried unto God with my voice, even unto God with my voice, and he gave ear unto me. We trust the Lord to bless his word to each of our hearts for his own namesake. Hymn number 221. Hymn number 221. Come every soul by sin oppressed. There's mercy. There's mercy with the Lord. And he will surely give you rest by trusting in his word. Hymn number 221. We'll stand together as we sing. Let's stand together. Father, we pray that thou be pleased to save souls tonight. We ask that some sinner would just cry unto God, and we know the Lord will hear and answer their cry. Save tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.